Welcome back to our new Oklahoma sports scene here at the Cherokee Hard Rock Casino. Presented by the Cherokee Nation at the Replay Sports Bar after a fun time at the Billy Burger this past week, huh?
Yeah, we took a break from the Replay Sports Bar, but it was worth it when we got some of those Billy Sims burgers. He's doing a great job out there at 21st and Yale. They're doing a great job here with 51 TVs to watch sports on. We got another big sports weekend coming up. OU and Texas Tech this Saturday. We've got OSU coming off their loss. Got a lot to talk about in this show, but wherever you're watching college football, bring the party out here to the Hard Rock Casino in Catoosa. It's a great place to watch football this weekend.
And they sent us a lineup of some of the big shows coming up here and some of the attractions here at the Hard Rock, too.
Yeah, Thursday, November 4th, Hank Williams, Old Bo Cephas is going to be here. Tickets are already sold out for that one. But on November 13th, they've got one you might like, Rain, a tribute to the Beatles.
Oh, yeah, that's my era. That's right.
Yeah.
Do you remember them?
Since John and George couldn't be here, they'll have the tribute band November 13th. Tickets are on sale for that. Other concerts, free concerts coming up on Thursday the 11th, Shenandoah, that great country music group from the 1980s, The Great Divide. I've not heard of them, but they're great as well. Big promotions happening out here as well. The Million Dollar Fright Night, that's where Chris Lincoln jumps out of the hallway while you're actually.
$1 million. November 30th, right?
Five winners get to play for their chance of winning $1 million, and it's Tulsa's best Halloween party, a $10,000 costume contest returning on October 30th. The party going from 7 p.m. to 2 a.m. Registration for the costume contest at 8 p.m. and judging starting at 10:30. So lots happening out here at the Hard Rock Casino.
And that's their lineup for the Hard Rock Casino, the number one casino in the entire area, of course. Let's take a look at our lineup now. Major League Baseball, the World Series is underway. That's right. It's the Houston Astros against the Atlanta Braves, and the game series already underway. And if they do go all seven games, we'll have baseball until the 3rd of November. Bob Carpenter, the voice of the Washington Nationals, is going to be here to join us and talk a lot of baseball, a lot of great stories.
Well, it's hard to believe that of all the teams playing college baseball, the University of Tulsa isn't one of them. But we'll go back down memory lane with our man Roger Whitaker. He's just released a book on the rich history of the University of Tulsa baseball team and is set to talk about it with us.
And Thunder Up, the Oklahoma City Thunder season is underway. The NBA has started their 75th season. You've got a special guest for us.
Yeah, Christine Butterfield. She's our Thunder insider from 107.7, the franchise in Oklahoma City, and does a great job covering the Thunder for them. She'll join us to give us some insight on what these first few games have been like. She's a little happier about it than most fans have been, for sure.
We'll review Week 7 of college football. Look ahead to this Week 8 coming up this weekend. Now, the hot topics, well, they got to start, I guess, with the AAC expansion, the American Athletic Conference. They've jumped in now, and I have a trivia question for you here, Grant. What has three TUs and three owls?
Oh, gosh. The AAC, I'm sure.
The New American Athletic Conference, that's right. We have the University of Tulsa, we have Temple University, Tulane University, and the three owls are Temple, and the new additions, Rice, and Florida Atlantic, FAU. They also join North Texas. USGA, the Texas San Antonio club, is playing good football this year.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
UAB, Alabama, Birmingham, and Charlotte. Quote here from Rick Dixon, our good friend, the athletic director at University of Tulsa. We have added established institutions from major cities into the American football footprint, with 13 of our schools now among the top 70 Nielsen Media Market. So they're pretty pleased with that. And geographically, should work well for the University of Tulsa.
It's going to work out. The trips might be a little longer to some of those places, but it's going to be a lot of fun for the AAC fans and the TU fans. And got a lot of other stuff happening. Cowboys and Cyclones this past weekend. OSU getting their first loss after that 24-21 loss in Iowa. Cowboys now 6-1, 3-1 in the Big 12, despite a great day for former Bixby High School star Brennan Presley, who scored two touchdowns, had six catches for 84 yards and three kick returns for another 67 yards. This week, too, Kansas and OSU, they'll get to take their turn with the Jayhawks. So,
well, obviously, the University of Oklahoma took Kansas about as seriously as we all did, and it showed in the first half, miserable first half, down 10-0. But then they cranked it up, scored in the last five possessions, 35 points, and beat the Jayhawks 35-23. Now Oklahoma, the only unbeaten Big 12 team at 5-0, 8-0 on the season. But well, they were not a happy group. It was funny. Somebody said, "Well, you know, Lincoln Riley, you're so controlled and not emotional." And so, what was the scene at halftime? He goes, "Oh no, They were yelling and screaming at halftime. He was really upset, but he got their attention anyway.
Yeah, he apparently did. I wouldn't have wanted to have been in that locker room for anything.
Bad time.
FC Tulsa needed a win or a draw this past Saturday night in Indianapolis to secure their second straight postseason USL Championship playoff spot. Got it with this goal in the 78th minute by Jason Johnson.
Record 13-12-5, 44 points. They grabbed that fourth and final playoff spot, just beating out to Oklahoma City for that. They will host Saturday at One Oak Field in the final week of the regular season, that same Oklahoma City team. So get out there to support FC Tulsa. And Oilers hockey season is underway now, Grant.
Yeah, on the ice, the Oilers open their 21-22 home schedule this Saturday night at the BOK. They're playing the Kansas City Mavericks. First puck drop at 7:05. They start a five-game homestand with games November 4th, 6th, and 7th, hosting Idaho. Another game versus Kansas City on the 12th. All home games at the BOK start at 7:05. So,
well, we're going to come back and talk about a number of other things here, including one of your friends, lost his job today.
Yeah, huh? Matt Wells got let go from Texas Tech after that loss to Kansas State over the weekend. A lot of folks on the outside wondering what in the world happened. I can tell you this. I've known Matt Wells my entire life. We're all Salisaw guys and, you know, not a finer guy out there. He brings a lot of character wherever he goes. And Texas Tech really missing out on Matt, but you know, their fan base is also missing out on a lot of patience, and the tide was turning pretty quick. So
Sonny Cumbie is the interim coach as he brings the Texas Tech club into Norman for their football game on Saturday. Well, much more on that a bit later on. We come back though, we're going to talk some more sports here for you. Look forward to having you stay with us on the Oklahoma sports scene.
Want to play a game? Then join us for $1 Million Fright Night. Saturdays, October 9th through the 30th from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. We'll draw five players to carve off a share of up to $1 million cash. Start earning entries October 1st at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa.
Tulsa's top spot for a good time awaits you. Come experience award-winning entertainment and nightlife. Escape and relax. Savor every bite. Then bring it all in for your encore. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Voted Tulsa's best.
The world-class thoroughbreds are racing at Remington Park. There's live racing now through December 17th. So don't miss all the action on the track and in the casino. Send your heart racing at Remington Park.
At Rogers State University, we keep things personal.
It all starts here.
We make sure our graduates get the most out of their education.
RSU has campuses in Claremore, Bartlesville, and Pryor, with on-campus housing and a wide variety of programs to suit your needs.
It all starts here.
Rogers State University.
So how did Billy Sims reinvent the burger? Easy! By starting with an all-out hands-down love for the juiciest burger this side of the 50-yard line. Combine that with craveable sides and shakes, and you have the best home-style crafted burger. You gotta check this out!
And welcome back to Oklahoma Sports Scene, the new Oklahoma Sports Scene presented by the Cherokee Nation. We're here at the Replay Sports Bar here at the casino. And our good friend Bob Carpenter is joining us here, Mr. Baseball, as far as we're concerned, from Tulsa here. Longtime friend of mine. He was the guy who took my job at Channel 8, right, Bob?
And, you know, it was really tough to get you fired. it took many, many months for that to happen. Obviously, what really happened was that you and Keith Brentz and Jim Wilburn left the station together, made billions of dollars doing horse racing.
Winter communications.
Leaving the scraps to all of us up on Signal Mountain or whatever that's
Lookout
called.
Mountain.
Lookout Mountain
that's
up
right.
there. And Chris, it was great to work with you back then. We kind of did our play-by-play thing with the Roughnecks.
He taught me soccer. I might have taught him a few things, but he taught me soccer for sure.
I just happened to grow up in St. Louis where I lived in an ethnic neighborhood surrounded by 20 other ethnic neighborhoods, and we all played soccer growing up, and I think I was the only guy in Oklahoma who knew what a free kick, a goal kick, or a corner kick was.
And you taught
but those
me well,
were great times. You and I had a blast
Absolutely.
With those teams with Billy Caskey and Victor Moreland, Noel Lemon, all
wow.
those characters,
they
Charlie
characters.
Mitchell and
sure.
Alex Kotarek, who still live around here.
He's at my
days.
Gym, the Titan Fitness Center.
Who is?
Alex Kotarek.
I would not want to work out next
no,
to
I
Alex.
No, I stay away from him. Yeah.
The guy's like 80 years old and he still looks like he's 25.
Hasn't changed a bit. Unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, it's World Series time. Game one of the World Series was Tuesday night in Houston as the Astros, the American League champions, host the National League champion, the Atlanta Braves. Bob, how do you see the World Series?
Well, it's hard not to favor the Astros.
And they're favored by a bunch. They're
you
big
know,
favorites.
Their offense is just really cooking right now. But really, the team that pitches better is going to win the World Series. And the odd thing about this whole setup, it's the same as it was 2 years ago when my Nationals played the Astros. Four of the games were in Houston. Guess who won all four of those games? The Nationals. We had three games in D.C. Guess who won all three of those? The Astros. It's the only World Series in history where the visiting team won every game. Nobody could win at home.
I remember that. That's right.
Yeah, and it
2019,
was 2019.
Right?
Yeah. And the Nationals actually beat the Dodgers on the road in Game 5 with a Howie Kendrick grand slam to beat the Dodgers in extra innings and then swept the Cardinals in the League Championship Series to play the Astros. So Houston had more wins than we did. They got home field advantage. So they have home field advantage against the Braves. Yeah, the last time these two teams met, they were both in the National League. It was back, I think, in it was like 01, 02. And they had an epic, like, 18-inning game that decided that series. I get to see the Braves a lot. I only get to see the Astros once every 3 years. I really like Atlanta. I like what they're doing. I like their pitching a little better
than
the Astros. Yeah. I hate to make predictions, but if the Braves win this thing, I will not be as shocked as a lot of other people will, because I got to see them all year, and I see them 19 times every year.
Right.
They're a really good mix, even without Ronald Acuña Jr., who got injured and couldn't play the last couple of months. Even without him, they're a really good offensive team. They play good infield defense, and I like their pitching and their bullpen.
Yeah.
You know, as far as the Braves go, they've, of course, got a fan base that spreads out all over the country. I think you could thank TBS of the 80s for that. Yeah.
As geographically as big as the Cardinals fan base.
Yes.
The Braves of all the southern states and the Cardinals of the Midwestern states.
But it's interesting to have two southern teams facing off against each other, because we seem to hear a lot more about it that around here, this time of year down here.
Yeah, it's kind of like the two-toned tractor ball caps in the Southeast against the cowboy hats and the boots in the Southwest with Houston. I think it's very intriguing. Probably not the matchup that the networks had hoped for. They were hoping for the Yankees to get through, of course.
Yeah.
Boston is a huge market.
The Dodgers. They didn't make it.
And, of course, on the National League side, the Dodgers with that vast market out there. So, you know, hey, that's their problem. They got to sell the ads. They have to worry about the you know, the ratings. I'm all for good baseball. And I really think the best two teams, the teams that were playing the best in October, made it through. And I find that quite refreshing.
Dusty Baker, you're the second oldest manager to manage a World Series team. I didn't realize that.
And Dusty was our guy in D.C. for a couple of years.
72 years old, that's right.
Yeah, and I got to know Dusty a little bit during that time. I had met him a time or two before that. But when you're around a guy every day, you really get to know him. Johnny B. Baker Jr. is his actual name. I don't know when he became Dusty. He's got the toothpick in his mouth at all times. Supposedly, back when he was playing, he and some of his teammates invented the high five. Everybody else was, you know, doing all the other stuff, and they were doing the high five. Just a fantastic guy, a player's manager. And I heard a story about him that tells you how much he loves his players. If it was September, and a lot of guys have incentives in their contract, games played, at bats, maybe for the pitchers it starts, he would go around the clubhouse in early September to mid-September, stopping by the lockers of some of the veteran guys and say, hey, Chris Lincoln, what kind of incentives do you have in your contract that I can help you reach in the month of September? I have never, ever heard of a manager doing that. That shows you how much Dusty Baker cared about his players. Wanted them to be successful, but also wanted them to make the money that he thought they might be entitled to. And that's a fantastic story about a guy like Dusty taking care of his guys.
This is the Astros' third World Series in the last 5 years, Bob.
Well, a lot of people think that the Nationals, my Nats, saved baseball by beating them in 2019. Because after that, during the offseason, is when all the news came out about the scandal of them banging the trash cans and having the camera hidden in center field and knowing what kind of pitches were coming, which is a total disrespect of the game. Their general manager, Jeff Luhnow, who I met in St. Louis, he was working under John Mozeliak and Walt Jocketty in St. Louis. The Houston GM, he lost his job because of that. Their manager, A.J. Hinch, got fired, although he has since resurfaced. back in your old neighborhood in Detroit,
managing the Tigers.
Yeah,
that's right.
And I remember a soccer trip we took up there one time when the Roughnecks were playing the Detroit Express.
That's right.
And we had to go out out to Warren, I think, and drive through your old neighborhood
out
there.
All the old girlfriends were running out. And, I don't know.
I thought they were otherwise employed at that time. But, you know, and then and Alex Cora, he was on that staff.
Right,
he lost his job. Ironically, he ends up managing with the Red Sox in Boston. So there was a lot of fallout. So the Astros have been really successful, but there are still people in baseball who hate what they did. I'm one of them. I don't hate them. I hate what they did. The old, you know, love the sinner, hate the sin sort of thing.
Right.
They shouldn't have done that. It was a total act of disrespecting the game of baseball. And a lot of people, a lot of fans will never forgive them for that. And maybe they shouldn't.
I've never seen more angst on social media toward one team in baseball ever than we've seen toward the Astros now that they've made it.
It's one team. It's one thing to hate a team for winning. It's another thing to hate a team for cheating. Mm-hmm. And like I said, for a lot of fans, that will never go away.
Sure.
Okay, Bob Carpenter, the voice of the Washington Nationals for how many years now, Bob?
16 in D.C. and 38 overall in the big leagues.
They did not pay him enough money for the season he went through this past year. We'll talk about that when we come back with Bob Carpenter. Stay with us.
Get onto the stage during It's a Hard Rock Life, Tulsa's first live audience game show. Play, watch, or win November 10th, 17th, and 24th as guests compete at both 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. for cash and prizes. Free to enter with a one-star rewards card at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Tulsa's top spot for a good time awaits you. Come experience award-winning entertainment and nightlife. Escape and relax. Savor every bite. Then bring it all in for your encore. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Voted Tulsa's best.
The Tulsa Oilers are back at the BOK Center for the 70th season of Tulsa hockey. Join the Oilers for opening night Saturday, October 30th at 7:05 as they take on the Kansas City Mavericks. For tickets, call 918-632-7825 or visit TulsaOilers.com and get ready to defend the rig.
We're back on the No Close 14 with the old Bob Carpenter and the old Chris Sager and the still young Grant Merrill here. But Bob, let's talk about it was a long season for you, the voice of the Washington Nationals, and a tough year for you.
Well, it's been a tough 2 years because we won the World Series in 19.
That's 2 years ago.
It's hard to believe. And then the pandemic hits. We only play a 60-game season in 2020. I'm glad we did play some baseball in 2020. But other than Juan Soto winning the batting championship at the age of 21, as we tape this, by the way, he just turned 23 today.
Wow.
And he's got all these unbelievable numbers. I mean, this kid's going to make so much money. He might own the Capitol, the Washington Monument, and one of the memorials by the time he's done. But 2 years ago, and then the COVID season was really rough. The Dodgers won that abbreviated season World Championship. And then this year, we had a bunch of injuries. A guy who was a star for the Red Sox down the stretch, Kyle Schwarber, was our leadoff
guy. That's right,
He hit 25 home runs for us, pulled a hamstring in the middle of June. He was headed for a 50-home run season. And then we eventually traded him to the Red Sox along with Max Scherzer and Trey Turner to the Dodgers. Even with some of our guys healthy, the Nationals were not having a good year. Our bullpen just blew up a lot of games late. And, you know, we really struggled in that respect. And in baseball, it's kind of like giving up a three-pointer at the buzzer, a goal at the buzzer, or a touchdown on a Hail Mary, the last play of the game. When you lose a game in the ninth inning because of your bullpen, it just rips your heart out. And in baseball, you know, you have to have a short memory because there's always a game the next day. But in this situation, there was, and it kept on happening. So even with some of our star players, we weren't going anywhere through June and July. And finally, on July 30th, which this year was the trading deadline, our general manager, Mike Rizzo, who hated to do it, traded Max, he traded Trey Turner to the Dodgers. He traded Daniel Hudson, our really good reliever, who got the last out of the World Series 2 years ago, traded him to San Diego. Brad Hand, who struggled, to Toronto. And a couple other guys, our catcher, Yan Gomes, an infielder, outfielder, Josh Harrison, who was great for us, traded all those guys. And we basically finished the season with Ryan Zimmerman, Josh Bell, a couple other guys, Juan Soto, of course, of major league caliber, and then a whole bunch of young kids playing the field and pitching. And that was a rough go of it. We won only 65 games.
Yeah.
And we didn't lose 100. That was the good news. But just about everything that could go wrong did. And now we're in a rebuilding mode. And we'll see where young Mr. Soto can take us this coming year and down the road as well.
Until the Yankees get him.
Well, that's the big rumor. But everybody thought Bryce Harper
that's
was going to be a
that's
Yankee
right, yeah.
or a Dodger. Yeah. That never happened. He ended up with the Phillies. The Phillies, for crying out loud,
I know it.
Our most bitter rival.
Yeah.
But, you know, we'll see how it all shakes out. I hope that we give Juan Soto the bank because he's the kind of kid you want to build your team around.
Oh, nice.
Not only a great hitter, he's an improving outfielder who could win a Gold Glove someday.
Yeah.
But his character, his support of his teammates, his presence in the clubhouse for a kid who's now just 23 today is absolutely amazing. Yeah.
How far do you feel COVID set baseball back?
Well, financially, way back. Yeah. No, it didn't hurt anybody worse than our team.
Sure.
We're coming off a World Series win. Your season tickets usually go up 20 or 30%.
Sure.
You know, everybody wants to come to the ballpark. You're the defending world champions. There were no fans in the stands. The Nationals got none of that. I don't know what the figure is, but I would say that we lost a couple hundred million dollars in revenue by not having fans in the stands in 2020. So as the defending world champion, our players didn't get to take their victory lap. They didn't get the ring ceremony that everybody wants. They eventually did it.
And you got a ring, right?
Yeah, I did.
That's
and I
right,
should have
yeah.
brought it out.
I know
next time
it.
We do this, I'll
we'll
bring
do it.
It.
That's right.
In fact, I'll bring my ring from the Cardinals in 04 and from the Nationals in 19. The one from 19 is about three times bigger than the other one.
Is that a more diamonds than Debbie has on her ring?
It's this ring that I got from the Nationals has no comparison to the wedding ring that I gave her 42 years ago. Now,
42 years
we're still
Debbie,
sticking around.
Yeah, great gal.
That's great.
Hey, I got to bring you back to, I think, where your heart still is, St. Louis. You're a St. Louis native. You had a chance to call the Cardinals, work with the Cardinals and stuff. And what a streak they were. 17-game win streak.
17 in a row. I never saw anything like it.
I think
our 19 Nats won 8 in a row, 10 in a row at one point. Maybe 11, I can't remember. But and then for Mike Schilt to get fired. Mike was one of the most decent, nice, respectful men I've ever met in any walk of sport, much less baseball. That hurt me because you know, I had forged a pretty good relationship.
Yeah.
He was really close to my sister Judy, who retired 3 years ago.
She worked for the Cardinal office.
Judy worked for the Cardinals for 52 years.
Oh my
for
gosh.
Eight different general managers.
Wow.
Going all the way back to being Devine in the early 70s.
Yeah.
So that was a tough one. Oliver Marmol named the Cardinals manager on Monday. He's 35 years old, the youngest manager in baseball. We'll see how he does. Mm.
You know, we were talking off the air earlier about Mike Shannon retiring. You have any good Shannon stories from back in the day that you can tell?
this one I can tell on the air. Okay, this is a horse racing story.
Oh, good.
He and I worked, this is years ago, probably 02, 03. We're working on radio together. We're at Candlestick Park in San Francisco, Pacific time zone. It's a Saturday afternoon, early in May.
Ah.
I come over from TV to work three innings with Mike. We're about 10 seconds from break. And Colin Jarrett, the engineer, says, Mike, 10. Mike, 8 seconds. Mike's in the back of the booth watching. He's watching. actually,
Derby.
It was a little later in that.
Oh.
Mike turns, without even turning around, Mike says to me, he goes, take over, big boy. It's post time at Belmont. So there was no way he was going to miss the Belmont Stakes.
That's great.
So I took his fourth inning. He took my fifth inning. That's my favorite story about Mike Shannon that you can actually talk about on the air.
Hey, please tell me we're not going to have a lockout. I've heard some really dire things they're talking about.
You mean lockout?
Yeah, lockout.
We already had a lockdown.
Lockout.
No, you're talking about the Players Association.
$4.17 million is the average salary for Major League Baseball.
Yeah, it's crazy. And the DH has to be decided. Some other rules changes.
Yes.
And good news is last week, they decided to start taking care of housing for the minor league players.
Oh, good.
These kids
yeah.
have been living in poverty
in
sponsors' homes
for
the last 20, 30 years.
Riding on buses.
So hopefully that's a good sign that the owners and the players, all this money out there, Chris. I remember Whitey Herzog saying one time, all this money and nobody's happy. Whitey said that late in his career before he got
that's
sick
smart,
of it and
yeah.
retired. Hopefully they'll have a settlement. And around the 30th of March, we'll be having opening day again.
Let's hope so. My gosh.
Well, lots of issues to work through there. And I'm sure, are there any minor details that have surprised you about the potential lockout?
I don't know a whole lot about some of the monetary issues. I do think the DH is going to become universal. I don't think the pitchers are going to be hitting next year. I used to think that was horrendous. If I don't see another pitcher bat anymore, I think it'll be okay with
me. What about Otani?
Ohtani. Well, he can play in the field and not be, you know, he can be the DH or the pitcher. Shohei Ohtani is one of the most amazing guys who's come along in baseball. And we get to see him next year because the Nationals will play the American League West.
Oh, you've been named by Baseball America as the Major League Player of the Year. You're going to get a lot more awards, too.
Bob, he should be the MVP in both leagues.
No doubt. Bob, can't thank you enough. Great
good to
see you,
buddy.
Good to have you back home, too.
We hear you live
good to
near
be on with you for the first time.
Yes, sir. And we hear you live near a Billy Sims. So
that's
we got
Billy Sims Barbecue Play, buddy.
Not too far from the 91st and Memorial location.
There you go.
I'm already over there once a week, so now I'll go a little
date
more.
Date night for you and Devin.
That would be a solo for me. GH way too healthy compared to me.
Thanks, Billy. Thanks again, buddy. We're going to come back with some more baseball. TU Baseball Memories straight ahead.
Want to play a game? Then join us for $1 Million Fright Night. Saturdays, October 9th through the 30th from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. We'll draw five players to carve off a share of up to $1 million cash. Start earning entries October 1st at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa.
Tulsa's top spot for a good time awaits you. Come experience award-winning entertainment and nightlife. Escape and relax. Savor every bite. Then bring it all in for your encore. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Voted Tulsa's best.
Billy Sims knows barbecue. How about nine meats, including brisket, chicken, pork, turkey, and ribs? Just to name a few, and seven home-style sides. We start early to slow smoke the most delicious meats for over 12 hours.
Every day.
Wherever you want. Online, dine-in, curbside, or carry-out. We've had a passion for over 15 years of serving delicious barbecue to people like you. Billy Sims has fast, drop-in friendly neighborhood service, loud enough for a tailgate and fancy enough for a wedding. Like we said, Billy Sims knows barbecue.
The world-class thoroughbreds are racing at Remington Park. There's live racing now through December 17th. So don't miss all the action on the track and in the casino. Send your heart racing at Remington Park.
So how did Billy Sims reinvent the burger? Easy! By starting with an all-out hands-down love for the juiciest burger this side of the 50-yard line. Combine that with craveable sides and shakes, and you have the best home-style crafted burger. You gotta check this out!
Welcome back to the all-new Oklahoma Sports Scene, presented by the Cherokee Nation. And, of course, we're in the Replay Sports Bar at the Hard Rock Casino in Catoosa. And, you know, it's hard to believe, Chris, that of all the major universities, that TU is not playing baseball. And we're here to relive some of the memories of when they did play baseball.
From the early 1900s, the University also had baseball. And they dropped the program in 1980. Mm-hmm. But boy, they had some years to remember. And the guy who is going to be able to remember this is this fellow right here with us. Joining us now on the set, Roger Whitaker, with the book, A View from the Dugout. And boy, what a, I know, a heartfelt project this is. Tell us about how this all got underway, Roger.
Well, Chris, you know, we always had a lot of Tulsa guys on our team. And because of that, a lot of us stayed in town, and we still get together every month. You've come out to some of our luncheons once in a while and joined us. And we still sit around till the same old stories over and over again. And it was a COVID year, and one of the guys said, you know, you ought to just write a book on some of these stories. So I kind of filed that away, and then I thought, well, I'll ask Wayne McCombs about it. He's written books before.
Our baseball historian, great guy.
Absolutely. Yeah. Fabulous guy. And Wayne said, you've got to go do it. I'd already watched enough Netflix movies for COVID, so I said, okay, let's write a book. Wayne said, you can use my archives. He brought over his file cabinets and all of that, and then the rest of it's history. I mean, it was a great, great experience.
206-page coffee table book, View from the Dugout. I loved your quote where you said, what is said and happens in the dugout
stays in the dugout. Absolutely.
Well, you had a lot of great memories. I know that, you know, just talk about some of the biggest highlights of playing Tulsa baseball.
Well, take us to 1969, the College World Series.
That was probably the highlight. You know, I mentioned that we were made up of mostly Tulsa kids. That was one of Gene's formulas, was to recruit
Coach
Tulsa
Gene
first.
Schell.
Coach
yep.
Gene Schell. Yep. Recruit Tulsa kids first. And then, so we grew up together. We played against each other in Little League, high school, Legion ball. And so for us to come together and have the success that we did, it was just like family growing up and accomplishing
Roger,
something
special. Roger, one of the star outfielders for TU, and he had a great story as you got into the ballpark to play the mighty Texas Longhorns.
Oh,
talk about the incident you had with their all-star quarterback, James Street.
James Street. Yeah, everybody wants to hear about the elevator story, but it's true. We stayed in the same hotel with Texas. We beat UCLA the night before, and I was on the elevator with Cliff Butcher and a couple of guys, and James Street and a couple of Texas guys walk on the elevator. James Street's pitching that night against us, and he looks over at me and says, "Who are you, the bat boy?" So that didn't sit too well, you know. And so I said, "Okay, I've got to file that away and remember it." So I think it was in the fifth inning. Steve Rogers is throwing a great game, no hitter. And I come up and hit a three-run home run off of James Street. And as I'm rounding second base, I just holler at him and say, "You know, that's how the TU bat boys hit."
That's awesome.
So, but I got him later also. I had to get one more last jab in. He hung a straight change on me up in my eyes. But I told the sports writer, he asked me what I hit, and I said, "It's fastball." And then James Street read that in the newspapers. It was not happy about that at all. So I got the last jab in on him.
That's great.
You know, there's not many James Streets in the world that had the chance to be the quarterback for the Texas Longhorns and the starting pitcher. I know I was there for his last public appearance at the Little Rock Touchdown Club where he spoke, and then he died less than 30 days later.
I know.
It was just a sudden thing. But I think he mellowed out in his later years. He seemed like a pretty nice guy.
Yeah, he's a good guy if you get past, you know, that burnt orange.
Among the nuggets you found, I found this incredible. In 1930, TU had not one, but two baseball teams.
Two baseball teams. It's a funny story about that. I'm out on the lake fishing with a buddy of mine, a TOT professor, and I thought the sport started in 1945. And Wayne McCombs called me and said, "Hey, I found an archive, treasure of archive material." And he said, "Did you know it started in 1900? And I said, "No." I said, you know, I'd already, up in the 1970s, I thought only I was almost done writing the book.
Right, yeah.
So I go back and look at the archive material that he told me about, and sure enough, I'm going through and it started in 1900, and then I realized 1929, we had a men's and a women's baseball team.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, go
figure. A league of their own, huh?
A league of their own, you know, absolutely. But it was hilarious. It was very interesting to read about the women's baseball team and that kind of thing. Yeah. But it was great.
Well, I know that had to be interesting going back and finding out all the information about that, because there's not a whole lot of people who remember 1929, much less wrote about it. So.
Absolutely. And a lot of the material I got back then, of course, was from the TU's paper, the Collegian. And great articles in there. That was a lot of the research material that I used in those early days, you know.
We got to talk about one of my favorite characters. I was fortunate to cover him in my early years here at, when I was at Channel 8, Gene Shell. I mean, an absolute legend in the sport, and lost him, of course, very recently, but just a great fellow.
Absolutely. He's old school. I don't think you could coach like that these days with these kids, but he knew how to win.
Yep.
He was a battler. He was tough. He gave us tough love, but he brought the best out of us, and just a great, great coach.
Well, I know you had more than one memory from the Texas game. Of course, your memory with James Street, but you had some pretty big highlights in that one as well, in that series.
Oh, yeah. I got off to a really good start in the series. I had about, I don't know, 7 RBIs in the first 2-3 games. Even Sports Illustrated took me and Les Rogers, a couple of other players up. But the very first game, the UCLA game, I still have nightmares about this one play. You know how big Chris Chambliss is, of a man.
Yeah.
And all I wanted to do, my very first fly ball, I wasn't intimidated by the team, but I wanted to get the nerves out of the way, have a nice, easy fly ball into left field and get that first out of the way. Well, Chris Chambliss comes up and hits a pop-up on the, well, it actually came to short left field, went above the light standards. Nobody could find it. Phil Lehane cuts it short. Les Rogers at third. Two All-Americans, they wouldn't leave the dirt path to come out in the outfield because they didn't know where it was. So I'm coming charging in. I finally find the ball, and well, I finally found it. It was behind my head.
Oh, wow.
So I reached back, fortunately snagged the ball, but fell flat on my back.
But made the out.
Made the out. I look up. Chris Chambers has already rounded second, heading to third. Then I got a standing ovation from the fans. And the only thing I can figure, they like a circus act. So,
TU that year, the 69 World Series, would end up finishing second to that great Arizona State baseball team. Yep. Came back to the World Series in 71. And again, just shut the program down in 1980. Do you think we'll ever see baseball back at the University of Tulsa? I know you guys are working hard for it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to say never. It'd be a tough climb, but if it's going to happen, I think the administration who we have at TU now, they remember what Tulsa baseball did meant to TU and the city. We were truly a Tulsa's team. So I think there's a chance, but it's going to be a tough one.
You've seen some of the old photos and stuff as we're doing the interview here. I want to thank Bruce Howard at TU and the folks there. They did an incredible documentary called Golden Moments. You can see that. Go to TulsaHurricane.com, Golden Moments. Mm-hmm. Thank them for giving us this video. And thank you, especially, Roger, for bringing this book
Absolutely.
Out here, making it available. And just incredible. The view from the dugout. It is available $39.99 on Amazon.com. If you're a TU fan or just a sports fan, you need to get yourself a copy of this. It's worth it for sure. Roger, thanks for taking the time. We have something for you, too, here. Another
awesome. We've got a Billy Sims
gift card in just a second here.
Okay.
Thank you, Roger. Appreciate it. Roger Whitaker.
Thank you very much.
To your baseball memories. Thank you so much. We're going to come back with a special guest of yours, right?
Absolutely. Christine Butterfield, our Oklahoma City Thunder insider, joins us next on Oklahoma Sports Scene.
The Tulsa Oilers are back at the BOK Center for the 70th season of Tulsa hockey. Join the Oilers for opening night Saturday, October 30th at 7:05 as they take on the Kansas City Mavericks. For tickets, call 918-632-7825 or visit TulsaOilers.com and get ready to defend the rig.
Get onto the stage during It's a Hard Rock Life, Tulsa's first live audience game show. Play, watch, or win November 10th, 17th, and 24th as guests compete at both 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. for cash and prizes. Free to enter with a one-star rewards card at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Tulsa's top spot for a good time awaits you. Come experience award-winning entertainment and nightlife. Escape and relax. Savor every bite. Then bring it all in for your encore. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Voted Tulsa's best.
At Rogers State University, we keep things personal.
It all starts here.
We make sure our graduates get the most out of their education.
RSU has campuses in Claremore, Bartlesville, and Pryor, with on-campus housing and a wide variety of programs to suit your needs.
It all starts here.
Rogers State University.
We welcome you back to the all-new Oklahoma Sports Scene, brought to you by the Cherokee Nation. And of course, it's our pleasure to talk Oklahoma City Thunder. It may not be as pleasurable as some of the times we've gotten to talk about them because of some of the games that they've played and the fact that they're not winning a whole lot lately, but we're trying to dive inside and break some of that down with our friend Christine Butterfield. She's, of course, the Thunder insider for 107.7, the franchise in Oklahoma City, and is on air there with the Tyler Media Group station. So, Christine, thanks for being with us, and thanks for talking a little bit of Thunder with us right now.
Oh, I'm so excited. I mean, even though they've, you know, haven't won a lot of games, it's still a fun group to talk about, so I couldn't be more happy to come on your show.
Well, first of all, tell us a little bit about you and how you got hooked up with the Thunder and kind of what your day-to-day is like with the team, because I know you're covering them quite a bit.
Yeah. So, you know, the franchise brought me on. I was an intern for them a few years ago and then brought me on this season to really, or I guess last season, it just feels like a whole new season now that fans are back and, you know, availabilities have been better. So got back brought back on to the franchise to cover them this season. And day to day, it'll depend on whether it's a game day or whether there's practice availability. If there's practice, which there was today, I'll go ahead and go there. I'll get video. I will do a practice report, sort of a video package for them, and put that on online. And then if it's a game day, I will go over to the games early to hear as much availability from Coach Dagnall as I can. And then, you know, obviously watch the game, take notes. And then we have our post game show that night right after the game is over. So anytime the Thunder are doing anything, I will be covering it.
Well, I noticed that Christine, obviously after a slow start, but again, I look at the numbers here.
this Oklahoma City Thunder is the youngest team in the NBA. I look at the average, 23 years, 217 days, a young basketball squad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, even though they're young, you can tell they're learning and they're developing. And even though that's not kind of the trend in NBA, obviously the trend right now is to try to get a championship as quickly as possible. The Thunder are really trying to build a solid foundation for their future. And the best way to do that is with young players that want to learn and grow with the team's culture. And I think that's what they're building here with, you know, Josh Giddey coming in from Australia. He's been their biggest pickup. He was their number six pick in the draft last season. And he's really started to look impressive for them. And him playing along Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, they've really grown in the backcourt together, and they have really good young picks, and Trey Mann, Jeremiah Robinson-Earl have really been playing well, and they even have Aaron Wiggins on a two-way contract, and these players are really starting to build that chemistry, and I think they're going to be an exciting team for these Thunder fans to start watching.
You know, I've listened to a lot of sports talk radio over the past week, and our Oklahoma fans are kind of brutal on this Thunder team. They you know, it kind of rides a roller coaster, and when they're down, the fans are really down on them. Have you kind of gotten that feeling from going to the games? I mean, are the regular attenders and the people who are pretty faithful to come to the games, is that an issue with them?
The fans that come to the games could not be more supportive of this group. Whenever they are in the arena, they are as loyal as you can ask for. Basically, anytime, you know, Darius Bazley has an amazing dunk, or Lou Dort makes a defensive stop, or Shai Gilgeous-Alexander does Shai Gilgeous-Alexander things, they erupt. And it is so nice to have that atmosphere back in the arena. Although, like you said, the fans that don't come to the games, they can be pretty brutal. And I think that just comes from the fact that historically the Thunder have not gone through a rebuild scenario, and they haven't gone through this track of having to grind it out through the drafts to be able to get good eventually. They kind of got lucky the first couple of years that they got their picks and they really played out for them. And now they're kind of rebuilding from the start, and the fans aren't kind of used to that. So it's really just hit or miss on whether the fans are going to stay loyal, because the loyal fans are there and they're with this rebuild, but the fans that are used to winning are definitely not too happy.
Well, Christine Butterfield with us, she's the Thunder insider for the franchise in Oklahoma City. And Christine, you were there on that fateful night, and I look back at that date, March 11th, 2020, when the sports world stopped. It all began there with the Thunder, when they shut things down. You were there. Give us your impression of that. And then this first return, that was, it had been 592 days since a game was played in Oklahoma City with a crowd. And this past Sunday, of course, when they played the Sixers.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. It was just a whirlwind. I remember just seeing the refs talk to both of the coaches on both teams, and then the players were rushed into the locker room, and it was very strange, and they were bringing out the halftime performers so that they can kind of quell the crowd a little bit and ease the tension there. But you knew something was up. You know, announcements weren't being made, things were being prolonged, and then finally they did say that the game was going to be postponed due to COVID, and then it kind of toppled everything in the sports world, like you said. After that, you know, the Big 12 tournament gets canceled after the first two preliminary games were played, and then the NCAA tournament gets canceled, and then the NBA season gets postponed, and everything kind of dominoed after that. And I did cover the team last season, and there were no fans in the arena. You are as far away from the court as humanly possible to ensure that, you know, nothing would happen that no one wanted. And just being back in the atmosphere last night, seeing the fans excited, seeing everyone really latching on to that energy and the atmosphere in that arena, it was incredible. And it's been a long time coming, and I'm really glad that the fans are now getting to experience basketball again in Oklahoma City.
You know, the COVID-19 protocols have kind of been a source of debate over, you know, of course, vaccination in general has been a source of debate. But the NBA is really being a pioneer in what they're expecting of fans. I know that, you know, when they talked to us about media credentials, as I'm sure they did, you had to turn in a vaccination card, had to show some things to prove that you'd taken precautions, and had gone over with the fans that you interact with, your fellow members of the media. I mean, how are they reacting to that?
I can't speak for the Oklahoma City fans just because I haven't gotten really the chance to gauge how they feel about everything. Although the fellow media members and I understand that this is very precautionary because I think because of what happened in Oklahoma City 2 years ago, you know, that was kind of the spark that ignited everything becoming so serious, was it finally had made its way to Oklahoma City. And because of that, I think the Thunder are being very cautious specifically. And I think the whole NBA is too. You think about how close these players are to some people in the arena. You know, football is a little bit different. There's a wider space between the fans and the football team. There's a wider space between, you know, each helmet and how they're passing through air. I think the NBA players play closer together. They, you know, their contact is a lot, you know, a little bit more harsh. And the media members are closer to these players than, you know, in other scenarios. So we understand the precautionary measures and we're willing to do that just to make sure that we can cover them the correct way and that everyone can feel safe.
Christine, thank you so much for Thunder Insider for joining us. The Thunder last year were 22-50, finished 14th in the NBA West. Let's hope for better days ahead. Thank you for joining us. Appreciate it, Christine.
Thank you so much, guys.
When we come back, Grant's going to have a high school report. We'll have our Remington Race report as well. Stay with us on the new Oklahoma sports scene.
Want to play a game? Then join us for $1 Million Fright Night. Saturdays, October 9th through the 30th from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. We'll draw five players to carve off a share of up to $1 million cash. Start earning entries October 1st at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa.
Tulsa's top spot for a good time awaits you. Come experience award-winning entertainment and nightlife. Escape and relax. Savor every bite. Then bring it all in for your encore. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Voted Tulsa's best.
The world-class thoroughbreds are racing at Remington Park. There's live racing now through December 17th. So don't miss all the action on the track and in the casino. Send your heart racing at Remington Park.
Let's head over to Oklahoma City now in Remington Park, and Dale Day, the track announcer, looks ahead to the two-year-olds coming up.
As we move into the second half of the Remington Park season, it's time to start thinking about the major two-year-old stakes races at the end of the year. The $100,000 Trapeze Stakes features two-year-old fillies, and we may have a star to watch for that race in Morning Twilight. A rarity for an Oklahoma bred, Morning Twilight was a $310,000 purchase earlier this year at the Ocala two-year-old in training sale in Florida.
On the lead, Morning Twilight makes a bid against Presley's Artwork. Swinging off a run, here's Diamond and Gasoline, followed by Because. It's Morning Twilight now on the front with a furlong to go. Morning Twilight is there, but Diamond and Gasoline down the middle of the track is rolling. Diamond and Gasoline second, set to challenge Morning Twilight, and Morning Twilight trying to hold off Diamond and Gasoline. Morning Twilight reaching out for everything she has, and she will get the win, but she had to work. Morning Twilight on top by three parts of a length.
Bred by Joe Merrick of Sayre, Oklahoma, this two-year-old filly by Morning Line from the Medaglia d'Oro mare Sweet Golden Carol did not look like a six-digit type of horse when she won her career debut by only one length. She evidently was saving the wow factor for her second performance in the $100,000 Oklahoma Classics Lassie.
Bringing out Baby, trying to hold the advantage over Morning Twilight after a half in 45.7 seconds, top of the stretch. Morning Twilight on the inside now, guns for the front, and takes over up by a length to the outside third and gaining hits Pricey Legacy. Morning Twilight being asked inside the furlong pole. She is out by four and pulling clear. Hits Pricey Legacy moving into second. Morning Twilight broke the maiden just over a week ago. Tonight is a stakes winner, Morning Twilight by seven in the Lassie.
Undefeated in two starts, Morning Twilight races for a team of owners based out of Saratoga Springs, New York. Trained by Hall of Famer Steve Asmussen, if she continues to shine like she did in the Lassie, Morning Twilight could indeed be headed to big-time status at the age of three. We'll be keeping watch to see if Morning Twilight does indeed become the next Oklahoma-bred superstar. At Remington Park in Oklahoma City, I'm Dale Day. Now back to Sports Scene.
So get out to Remington Park. Live racing Wednesday through Sunday. It's some of the best sober racing around. And join them there. We'll have a Remington Report, of course, each week right here on the new Oklahoma sports scene. Well, anyway, it doesn't change, though, is our high school football is moving along and getting closer and closer to playoff time.
Yeah, district playoffs coming up, and we've got plenty to talk about as we get into the ninth week of the high school football season. Let's review week eight first. Of course, here are the Prep Red Zone Oklahoma top five polls from Michael Knight and his crew over there in Class 6A1. It's number one, Jinx, number two, Union, number three, Mustang, number four, Owosso, after that shocking loss to Mustang.
Couldn't believe that.
My gosh. Broken Arrow coming in at number five. Of course, some of the games this week, Union plays Southmore. You'll have the call of that one on KRMG this week. Owosso's on the road to Moore, and Broken Arrow's on the road to Norman. Class 6A2, nobody's coming close to Bixby. They're still 8-0 as they beat the Muskogee Roughers 56-14 this past week. They'll travel to Ponca City. My prediction, won't have any trouble there. Choctaw beat Sand Springs this past week. They come in at number two in Class 6A2. Booker T, Dell City, and Sand Springs all in line behind them. All right, in Class 5A, McAllister, Collinsville, Ardmore, Coweta, and Carl Albert. They will go in that order for Class 5A in the rankings. Big game between Collinsville and Pryor this week coming up in Class 5A. In 4A, it's Tuttle, Cushing, Poto, Clinton, and...
Flip over.
Yeah. Oh, flip over. There we go. And Grove, the Ridge Runners beat Cleveland 56-7 this past week. And big game between Grove and Wagner, who shut out Ooligaw.
That's what Michael's going to go to, he said.
Yeah, absolutely. So we'll be hearing all about that. Here's another big game in Class 3A. Holland Hall is going to Verdigris. Holland Hall is 8-0. Verdigris is 7-1. They have a big clash coming up this week. Holland Hall's on top of Class 3A in the Prep Red Zone rankings. Lincoln Christian, Heritage Hall, Berry Hill, and then Verdigris in line behind them. Washington, Beggs, Oklahoma, Christian School, Marlowe, and Victory Christian in Class 2A. And in Class A, Ringling, Cashin, Gore, Hooker, and Elmore City make up the top five in Class A. Big game between Cashin and Tonkawa coming up this week. That's kind of the game of the week in Class A as well. A couple of other top games, Noble at Ardmore, Bishop McGinnis, they're on the road to Guthrie this week. So that's high school football in a nutshell. Thank you to Preps Red Zone, the Oklahoma Preps Red Zone, for their top five every week.
And where do we hear all the scores on Friday night?
On the Prep Sports Post Game, 107.7 The Franchise in Oklahoma City. You can listen on 97.1 The Sports Animal in Tulsa, or you can watch on the free Squirtle app.
And we'll come back with our wrap and a parting shot, a personal one for my friend Grant Merrill here. Stay with us on the new Oklahoma sports scene here at the Replay Bar at the Hard Rock Casino.
Get onto the stage during It's a Hard Rock Life, Tulsa's first live audience game show. Play, watch, or win November 10th, 17th, and 24th as guests compete at both 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. for cash and prizes. Free to enter with a one-star rewards card at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Tulsa's top spot for a good time awaits you. Come experience award-winning entertainment and nightlife. Escape and relax. Savor every bite. Then bring it all in for your encore. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Voted Tulsa's best.
So how did Billy Sims reinvent the burger? Easy! By starting with an all-out hands-down love for the juiciest burger this side of the 50-yard line. Combine that with craveable sides and shakes, and you have the best home-style crafted burger. You gotta check this out!
Billy Sims knows barbecue. How about 9 meats, including brisket, chicken, pork, turkey, and ribs? Just to name a few, and 7 home-style sides. We start early to slow smoke the most delicious meats for over 12 hours.
Every day!
Wherever you want, online, dine-in, curbside, or carry-out. We've had a passion for over 15 years of serving delicious barbecue to people like you. Billy Sims has fast, drop-in friendly neighborhood service, loud enough for a tailgate and fancy enough for a wedding. Like we said, Billy Sims knows barbecue.
The world-class thoroughbreds are racing at Remington Park. There's live racing now through December 17th. So don't miss all the action on the track and in the casino. Send your heart racing at Remington Park.
We welcome you back to the all-new Oklahoma sports scene presented by the Cherokee Nation. We're at the Hard Rock Casino in Catoosa, where don't forget this weekend, they've got 51 big screen TVs that you can watch your favorite football game on. Be sure and drop by and bring the party out here this weekend. They'd love to see you. Well, there's not going to be much of a party on the Texas Tech side this week when they come to see the Oklahoma Sooners. Of course, Monday, they parted ways with Salisaw native Matt Wells. Of course, another Salisaw native around here, well, that'd be me. I've known Matt my entire life. Over four decades, our families have been friends, and we were just very saddened to see the fact that Texas Tech decided to let go in the middle of the season in which he was 5-3 after a loss to Kansas State, who had beaten OU the past 2 years. They've got a lot of good things out in West Texas. They've got oil and gas and Lubbock and Amarillo and a bunch of nice places. What they don't have is a lot of patience or common sense. And I'm going to tell you one thing. As far as bringing in a new coach, they fired my Leach. They fired Cliff Kingsbury. Look where those guys are now. Matt Wells is going to bounce back, and what he brings as far as coaching goes far beyond X's and O's on the football field. Matt Wells is one of the most high character guys I have ever met, and he is just, they're going to be missing out on a lot when he leaves Lubbock. Now, I will tell you one thing, in the 3 years that I've followed Texas Tech, their fans and their media are as harsh as anything I've ever seen. Got to expect that when you're a college coach, but man, oh man, they're really going to miss out. I know they're going to forget it after this week that he was ever the coach there, but you know, what he brought a lot more to the table than just the game of football. Great guy, and he's going to bounce back quickly. I'd put my money on the Matt Wells stock for sure.
Well done. Well said there. By the way, Sonny Cumbie is going to take his place as the interim head coach. He was a quarterback with the Red Raiders under Mike Leach from 2000 to 2004. But the word is they're looking at Grant Harrell, right, who's out on the Arizona Cardinals staff in the NFL, to bring him back to Lubbock. But you know what? They've gone through some big coaches who've obviously gone on to better things.
Well, yeah, and you think about the people that they have in Texas right now, just in state. I mean, Jeff Traylor's down there at University of Texas San Antonio.
Undefeated
already. Sonny Dykes at SMU, they're undefeated this year. I mean, they don't have to look far to find some great candidates for that job. It's just, will they find a candidate who will put up with all the crap that Texas Tech brings to the table? Because their fan base is not forgiving, and they, you know, it's instant gratification. And that's the world that we're living in. You have to understand that going into these college football jobs.
Let's look ahead now to the weekend in college football, and it all starts actually on Friday night. University of Tulsa will be hosting the Naval Academy. That's a 6:30 p.m. kickoff. It'll be on ESPN2. Golden Hurricane with a well-needed week off after that exciting victory last one out. So they're starting to turn things around a bit at TU, and they're, by the way, are an 11-point favorite over the Midshipmen.
All right, and of course, the aforementioned coachless Texas Tech Red Raiders visit Norman this weekend. Of course, that's a 2:30 p.m. kickoff on your old stomping grounds, ABC. Then the Kansas Jayhawks are going to, OSU's going to take their turn in Stillwater with the lowly Jayhawks this week. Imagine if Texas Tech fans had to put up with Kansas Jayhawk football all summer long.
Oklahoma State favored by 30.5 points, but watch out. Oklahoma found out when they didn't pay attention there. By the way, the Sooners are a 22-point favorite over the Red Raiders. And with that coaching change and all the everything else going on there, I would think the Red Raiders are in for a tough afternoon.
Well, I was proud to see that the Arkansas Razorbacks came out to a 45-3 win over the University of Arkansas Pine Bluff. Actually, the winner in that game was the Golden Line Marching Band, from what I'm hearing. They put on the show at halftime that they always
do. That was a pretty historic game, though, right?
Yeah, first time since 1944 that Arkansas has played an in-state team. That was the old Barnhill, Frank Broyles rule that, you know, it was that thing where they didn't want anybody else to share the spotlight. And that was actually the first time in football that's happened. They'll play Arkansas State in 2 years, and it's the walls that Frank built are starting to come down. So
I hope you enjoyed this edition of our new Oklahoma Sports Scene show, and join us next week here, of course, Wednesdays, Friday nights at 10:30, 11 o'clock Saturday night, both here in Tulsa, Channel 3, and Oklahoma City, Channel 93 there. So join us for that. And we have a Breeders' Cup preview for you next week. Look at the big horse racing event coming up at Del Mar.
I'll try to be a little less irritated when we come back, too. So.
For Grant Merrill, I'm Chris Ling, and for all those who joined us on the show, Bob Carpenter, Roger Whitaker, and, of course, your lady,
Christine Butterfield.
Thank you so much, and we'll see you next time on Oklahoma Sports Scene.